Today we will talk about surge protection, and this will be part one. So this is today's plan. It has only 5 topics, but I hope that it will bring you some new knowledges. So a goal of this webinar is to help you, especially with proper selection and recommendation of surge protection. Because we have a lot of cases on this topic. And then further increase your knowledge about surge protection. The problematic is quite complex and I think that also interesting. But because of this, it's needed to divide seminar on several parts. And this part one will be about essential principles and concepts of surge protection. This part is very recommended for the next parts as a prerequisite. Then will be part two, I don't know, in 1 or 2 months, which will be about application and selection of surge arresters, and maybe can be also part number three, if you will want to, where will be presented special cases and special details. Today I would like especially about the principles, and I'm sure that you have a question about application, but if I can ask you to let them for the part two, because this part one is about the theory, but the theory is also needed. Thank you. So here is some overview of related standard. Not all standard, only the main from the point of view of surge protection. Here is one big pack of standards, 61.4.643, and there is another one backpack 62.305. And from this pack, it's especially general principles, and then about physical damage, and about electrical and electronic systems. And this in this webinar will be quotations from the above stated standards. We can divide surges into three categories. This is division by this standard. So we have lightning surges, switching, and temporary overvoltages. Lightning, everybody knows. Usually the higher stresses are on the external part of the structure. Within the structure are the effects lower because of I would say dampening of electric and magnetic field especially, and the light current is divided outside of the building. But very important is that even if supply, it means electrical supply, is provided by underground cable, the use of an SPD, which means surge protective device, it's our arresters, is recommended. And this is very important, and on the next part I will show you why it is so. Second category is switching overvoltages, which are caused by switching operation, by some fault or interruption. And for this is important that the stresses in terms of peak current and voltage are usually lower than lightning stresses, but have longer duration. And this is important because if the duration is very long, then the surge arrestor can be overheated. Yeah, because the lightning stresses are impulse stresses, which are very short. We have also three categories: temporary overvoltages, and these overvoltages are usually caused by some malfunction on high voltage part. It means, for example, loss of insulation between high voltage and low voltage, and or it can be some direct contact between high voltage and low voltage. Yeah. And important is that the temporary overvoltages has two dimensions, magnitude and time. But generally, according standard, the selection of surge rating of the arrestor is based on the stresses due to lightning. This is important. But this is only general rule, so in special cases may be very important switching overvoltages. But generally it is based on stresses due to lightning. So now we will focus on lightning, and there are four categories for the lightning and the effects. These categories are important because we see which damage and which effects it has. So it can be flashes directly to structure. You see these damages and risks. Very important is that the lightning, every lightning, also causes lightning electromagnetic impulse, because the lightning is a high frequency effect. Yeah. So this impulse causes induction. So second category are flashes near to the structure. You can see it also on this picture. Here is direct stroke, here is near the building, near the structure. Then we can have flashes to the lines and flashes near the lines. Yeah. Okay. And here we see that the surge protection devices are only part of the whole lightning protection system. This is very important because all parts of the lightning protection system must be properly designed and properly realized. Because without this cannot the surge protection device work effectively. Yeah. And we see that from the point of view of lightning protection is task of SPD is to provide lightning equipotential bonding. Yeah, this is very important. So here are some information about how the lightning protection system is divided. It's a whole system. It has external parts and internal parts. We will not talk about external parts. We know them. It's an air termination system, dome conductor and air termination system. But it is not our interest to design this part, because Schneider Electric don't provide these parts of lightning protection. For us is important the internal lightning protection system. There is also a term separation distance. I will talk about it later. It is also very important for the proper selection of SPD. Do you have some question about this part of presentation? No, okay, thank you. So, the lightning equipotential bonding. What does it mean? It means to connect separated metallic parts to lightning protection system, but either directly or by surge protective devices. It means that the all metallic parts should be on the same potential. This is very important. And all lines connected to the structure and also all internal systems should be protected by the surge protection device. Yeah. So we see that live conductors, of course, cannot be connected, cannot be bonded to the ground directly, so they have to be bonded by SPD. Some, I don't know, metal parts of building, for example, reinforcement in walls, pipes, and such parts can be directly bonded. And there is an exception, that lightning equipotential bonding is not necessary if lines are screened. In the screening must have some parameters which are described in this standard, and it is not quite easy because it must be calculated for the exact case. So usually, and it is a recommendation that all parts should be protected by SPDs or lines. Only project designer can say that this line is not needed, for this line is not needed SPD. So we can look on lightning parameters. Important is that lightning stroke has impulse character and high frequency spectrum, because this will cause us a lot of problems, because it creates strong electromagnetic field which causes induction into all conductive materials, and this is the reason why we need to bond them, because of this induction. So how the lightning protection system should be designed? According to the standard, there are four levels. These levels are because each level has different effectivity for the protection. So you can ask why not to protect it in the best level. It is because it is expensive. So for each building, each structure should be first done risk analysis calculation. And from this risk analysis calculation, you will get the required level LPL. And this calculation should be done by project designer. It is not work for us, because this analysis is extremely difficult to do, and without a special software it is almost impossible. And I did this analysis, and I can tell you that it is work for several working days to do it. So it is really very difficult. So from this analysis we will get the needed lightning protection system, and important is from our point of view that for each level we have maximum peak current of the lightning. So we see that, for example, for the level 1, which is the most effective, there is lightning current 200 kiloamps, which is very much. And for the lowest it's only 100. But also very important is the probability that the real lightning current will be lower. So we see that even for the highest level, level 1, there is 1% probability that the lightning current will be low, will be higher. It means that one stroke from 100 will be higher, and we see that it can cause a residual risk of damage. It means that even perfectly designed lightning protection, which means in some level, cannot assure 100 safety for the building. We see that for each level there is some probability that another damage will be caused, but important is that the damage will be decreased if the proper protection is designed. Yeah. But never you have 100% safety. And for example, for level 3 or 4, even one stroke from 20 can cause the damage. Okay, so this is, I would say, quite important picture, because it is a key for proper selection of search arrestor. You see on this picture is some simplified building. This building has external lightning protection. It is some lightning rod. Here is a lightning rope, which protects it also. And here is down conductor and grounding system. On the roof is some device. It can be, for example, air condition or, I don't know, solar panel, something, which is connected by lines into the building. And there is also lines with electricity connected to the building. Why is this picture so important? Because you see that the space is divided on zones. For example, LPZ0, it's outer zone. Yeah. And we see that for outer zone can occur direct flash and full lightning current. And we see also for the other zones which effects it can have. So this will help us to select the proper SPD for each part and each zone. So 0A is zone which is not protected against direct stroke. 0B is protected. It is protected by this air termination system, but it is outside of the building. Yeah. Then there is LPZ1, which is inside the building, and there no direct flash can occur. And there is also limited induced current. This is quite important, because between each zone should be also dampening of the induced current. Yeah, you see it here. And you see on this picture where should be the SPDs placed. You see that they should be placed on border between two zones. So, for example, this surge protection protects against direct current, which can be caused by lightning S3 into the line, for example. Yeah, you see it. But this SPD is inside of the building, and it is in one LPZ1 zone, and this protects especially against induced current, not against direct current. It is not its task. Here you see also direct bonding of all metal parts, for example water pipes. Yeah. And here you see that even the lines which are underground, because this is a ground level, so even the lines which are underground are in zone LPZ0A. So into these lines can get direct lightning stroke. And also this protection must be designed for protection against direct lightning. So here we see lightning current distribution example. Here is a building which is protected externally. Here is external lightning protection system. It is connected to earthing system, which is, I would say, very good, because 1 ohm, it's very good resistance of the earthing system. And this earthing system is of course connected into the building. It is a protection wire. Yeah. And this building is connected by low voltage from transformer. So on this line is, for example, 230 volts. Here is an equipment. Okay. So what happens in the case of direct flash? Through the down conductor will flow the lightning current. This is example for the worst case for the LPL1, which means 200 kiloamps lightning current. It will flow into the earthing system, and on the 1 ohm earthing system the potential will rise to 200 kilovolts. So we see that the potential of the protection wire in whole building and also all metallic parts which are connected to the earthing system will have a potential about 200 kilovolts. It wouldn't be so bad, because it would be all on the same potential. But if the building is connected by this line, on this line is different potential. Here is only 230 volts, which means that between protection wire and this line we will get almost 200 kilovolts. Which means, of course, that these parts will be immediately destroyed. Also the distribution box and all equipment in the building would be destroyed. And of course it is also very dangerous for people or animals. Yeah. On this slide we see how it will work with the SPD installed. This is quotation from standard that when no specific calculation of current sharing is carried out, a general assumption is that 50% of lightning current will flow into the earthing system of the structure, and 50% will flow back out of the building to the transformer and so on. So for LPL1 it implies that through this wire will flow about 100 kiloamps. And on protection wire will be potential 100 kilovolts, but SPD will open and it will bring the potential, the high potential, also on the line wire. So between line wire and the earthing system will be only 1.5 kilovolts. Yeah. So the equipments in the building will be protected. But through this line will flow 4 times 25 kiloamps into the transformer. Yeah. For us is important how the current will be divided. We see that it is 4 times 25 kiloamps. It means for the 4 wire system. If we will have here 4 SPDs, each one for phase and neutral, through each SPD will flow 25 kiloamps. If the line was only 2 wired, then the current would be 50 kiloamps for each wire. Yeah. So it divides equally. But if the building would be connected, for example, by 3 metallic services, 3 cables or so on, it will divide on the each cable which goes out of the building, and then will be only 8.3 kiloamps on each phase. This is example.